I wonder if Allegrin feels guilty. Alright, let's return with our findings then. I need someone who's guilty. Who feels guilty anyway. Speak. The Prince of the Fahat would hear your questions. Oh yeah, Herja? I figure Herja doesn't feel guilty. The newborn Maw feeds on guilt. If you want to know if Herja feels any remorse for her crime, let her face the Maw.
Making a note.
Yes, the voice murmurs. This is a perfect trial for a prisoner. She can stand before the Maw unless she has complete divorce herself from human feeling. The bloom will take its due. A fitting punishment. Once she has done this, she is free to go. Speaker crackles. You will find a disc on her forehead. Turn it 3 times Widdershins to release her from her prison. Tell her that if she survives the Maw, that she has earned her freedom. Alright. Pretty cool. Garkoto has agreed to release you, but only if you face the Maw and allow it to draw out your guilt. Huh! I have nothing to confess or to regret, so the Maw will find me a paltry meal. I accept your bargain. Yeah, we'll see about that. Ooh! Got this. The disc on her forehead pulses briefly and loses its cohesion to her flesh. It falls to the ground, and Herja's eyes widen as her imaginary prison disappears. I suppose I thought I was supposed to turn this Widdershins. She bends over to pick up the disc, and she passes it to you with a mocking smile. As a knight, I live by my honor, and it's my honor to put some miles between this place and me. A quick jaunt to this Maw, and then I'll show you my heels. I'll show my heels. Herja's prison. An artifact. This disc held Herja captive inside a psychic cage. Now inert, it looks like a flat circle of metal. You do not know how to reactivate it, but it might be valuable to a merchant. Looks like it is. Alright, let's see what happens. It's either going to take just your guilt or take everything of you. With a slight sneer, Herja steps toward the Maw. I will tell you what I regret, she declares. Let the bloom do its worst. Confidence shines from her face, and her proud carriage, even despite the filth that smears her armor, make her look every inch the knight she claims to be. The Maw's tongues reach out to her, grasping and tugging, and as they penetrate into her flesh and draw her close, you can see the first flickers of doubt and fear. Her eyes focus somewhere far away, and she addresses someone who isn't here. She begins to speak through gritted teeth, as if resisting the pull of the Maw on her memories. The spotted dozy, huh? I cared little for it, sister, but your sadness made me cry. She breathes deeply, and something inside her seems to break. Her stoic mask begins to crumble. No, they were mutants. I did what was right. They can be in denial, I guess, about it, and still feel it. I didn't mean for them to die. Not like that. Not painfully. Not twitching, frothing, kicking. Not the children. She swallows. I sold some of the metal before I crumbled it into the air. I thought the dose was still toxic. Tears begin to stream down her cheeks. Toxic it was, but not enough to drop them. The screams. That was the first time they ever seemed human to me. But skinning the yellow woman, her tentacles, her sting, she cried and wailed, but she was a monster. Her just sobs, and her voice drops to a monotone. Cutting out her babies was a blessing to her, stopping more monsters from entering the world. We all agreed, she thinks. We all agreed, but the children looked as human as any. Keep talking. She doesn't seem to hear, her voice reciting a litany of further crimes. When we brought the tunnel down on the diggers, I could hear their cries through the rubble. Rather than offer mercy, I gave them fire to steal away their breath. Indigo Tide? Her voice drones on, and somehow this makes her story more horrifying. I herded the weeping families into the spire, even though I knew that the resonances of the chamber would slowly shiver them apart. I hated them, I thought. but it was only because I feared my fellow's scorn. He thinks they were human, in every way that matters. What have I done? I called down the threshers, and I stood guard with my blazing spear to keep the fathers from saving their children. I laughed at their cries, and I disemboweled the one because I thought he might serve as a lesson. His blood ran with that of his children, and they all suffered to see the others in agony. We wagered over who would die first. She stops talking. I am a greater monster than ever they were. She thinks, I deserve a death worse than I gave them. I suppose any death will do, though. Delny breaks in. She is about to end her life. A piece of shattered synth lies on the ground nearby. Herja snatches it with her free hand and brings it to her neck. Tears pour down her cheeks, and she murmurs, I am so sorry. Grab her hand, initiative. 100. You grab her wrist before she can slash her throat, and her pain-filled eyes focus on you. Let me die, she whispers, and she leans into the synth. You can barely keep it from her. She is strong, and she clearly wants to end her agony. Might or intimidation? 60%? 80%? You know, hers is gonna be low. I also have 80%. Success! You manage to pry the synth shard away from her before she can do any lasting damage. To her body, at least. Her mind seems ruined. Well, it's supposed to take the guilt away. Her eyes are distant, almost vacant, and she stands on weakened legs. She totters a short distance and looks back over her shoulder at you. I am so sorry, she whispers, then stumbles away. You make that note. Air stirs around you, slowly at first, then a gust as the maw begins to open, expelling atmosphere from an alien world into little Nyliash. A black tunnel opens, the skein between worlds stretching taut and then snapping like a call from an infant's face. Where's it go? It goes to Lost Anchorage. Is that where you guys wanted to go?
Here comes the boredom slayer.
So I stopped her from killing herself. I've opened the maw, but I still need to find out what's on the other side. I know what's on the other side. Lost Anchorage. I've learned that the newborn maw feeds on guilt. I'll have to find someone or something that feels a powerful sense of guilt and offer them to the maw. Herja, a warrior I met in Little Nyliash, has been imprisoned for trying to poison a whole community of mutants. She claims to feel no remorse, but if she's lying, the maw might draw out her guilt. I'll need Garkoto's permission if I want to try this. Garkoto has given me permission to release Herja on the condition that she offers herself to the maw. Return to Kian. Yeah, that. Well, I stopped her from killing herself, but they can find her. Herja, the warrior woman I met in Little Nyliash, is tall and formidable. She might be an excellent recruit for the Decanted. The only problem is that she's currently a prisoner of Garkoto, the mutant prince. Well, if she had killed herself, I would have failed that part. But she walked away, so I don't know where she is. Hail, you in tank. So, Herja lives. Let us hope that she understands the magnitude of her actions. In time she may learn something of compassion. The grill sparks and fizzles as Garkoto worships. But such is not my experience. I'm not going in there yet. So you can just hang out. Some strange strangled sound comes from the grill at the front of the tank. Before you go, what became of the device that bound Zhezhe to a prison? They think, do not lie to me, human. I have worked hard to open this maw and to bring Herja to justice. I should be able to keep this disc as partial recompense for my efforts. Success. A pause from the speakers, and then... I agree. Your work has been exemplary, and it would be churlish of me to demand its return. The device is yours as a token of my gratitude. Tell me, what is the state of the new maw here in my settlement? I've opened the maw, Garkoto, but I haven't gone through it yet. When you have journeyed to the other side and told me what you found there, I will be happy to bestow your reward. Alright.
Why not?
Why not? Touch it! You touch it! What if it shocks me? Then we get to laugh at you. Nice. Tell you what. I'm gonna touch it. I'm gonna go in it.
Yes, now.
I'm gonna go in it now. Catena. Starship or something? Would you care for some refreshment, Bindari? My thanks, Seredic. Where's Methanwil? Right behind you, my dear. Oh, you startled me. A small pleasure. The trip has been surprisingly dull. Huh. Interesting. Look, Anstall, do you see the plumes of light? They're the remnants of Star's Passage. Star's Passage? What do you mean? They're not the stars themselves, nor the dead pieces. They are fluctuations in time and gravity. Will they bring in money or offer tribute? Extend my holdings? If not, they are worthless to me. You miss much, then. I will teach you someday. Huh.
Don't mind if I do.
Interesting. Bindari.
I'm ready.
Wait. I want to look at this. What? This is something new. Embedded in the metal wall is a complicated display. A number of charts seem to track positional variables. Unfortunately, the text is in a language you've never seen before, so you can't discern anything more. Vargellan, whose name is Torkra. Milady, I am measuring our cross-dimensional velocity by estimating the passage of certain landmarks. But the Catena will tell you if you just ask. This is so, but if I am to retain my mental acuity, I must exercise it. If you insist... But I would rather let my servants serve. Huh. Anything else? That's the same one. What about this?
I'm going.
I'm gonna loot the loot. 41 shins. And a sign? A cloak of deepest purple ripples with a life of its own. Upon donning the cloak, the wearer is instantly overwhelmed by a blissful state of relaxation and contemplation, as if undergoing vigorous deep tissue massage. Many a wearer has become so enamored... Something is delicious? A sprout? Enamored of the cloak... Yeah, you guys can try to read that. that they will jealously guard it with their lives. This particular model appears to have been made for a small child and does not fit you or your companions. You will soon enough, I'm sure. No hiding this one. I'm missing some of these conversations. Anstall, look! Look out the window! Must I on? Will it be so different this time? I suppose it depends on whether you value the journey or the destination. Wake me when we arrive someplace interesting. Hm. I want to see if that other one comes back. Something else over there. Even when we look at things in inventory... Oh my, we need replenishing of these things. Saradig, what is that Varge yelling by the window? His name is Torkrat Bindari. So yeah, this is obviously a starship. I want to see what that about sprouts. We got the window. This device appears to be one of the engines that once drove this vehicle. One more around, let's see. What's the latest news of Tanura? You haven't heard? This is delicious. She's not pregnant. She's going to sprout. What? Sprout? Apparently her illicit lover wasn't human. He pollinated her. Whatever she's growing isn't a baby. Huh. Has her husband found out yet? He will soon enough, I'm sure. No hiding this one. Sprout, what? Alright.
Alright.
Exactly. We're interacting with that? Let's loot this first.
Alright.
I'm glad you're so compliant. 40 shins and a telling. Ooh. This odd pair of gloves, made out of a thick brown leather-like material, feels comfortable and springy. Half icosahedral metallic studs are mounted on the knuckles. Very shiny and perfectly smooth, they appear to be made out of chromium and feel lukewarm to the touch under any conditions. When worn, the gloves quickly become a burden. The studs begin to make a faint buzzing sound. The longer the gloves are worn, the louder the buzz. After a few minutes, a pronounced fatigue sets in. The fatigue progresses until the wearer feels the same sort of numb sensation in their digits that one would have after wood carving or playing a string instrument for hours. They are impossible to wear comfortably after this point. Tucked into one of the gloves when you found them is a piece of paper. On it is a crude picture of the gloves, with various glyphs pointing to specific parts of the apparel. While fascinating, the glyphs do not indicate the glove's purpose. Alright, so something to sell then. Ditto with the sign. And this thing. I guess we're just keeping it to sell. In fact, yeah, that's what it says. I had a codex for, yeah, Maws? I already know about Maws. Characters, locations, creatures, Maw. The Maws of the Bloom appear as mouth-like orifices. Orifices? Surrounded by foul, questing tentacles called tongues. Each Maw harbors a singular desire, for instance, an emotion like hatred, human blood, or memories of happiness. Sating that desire will open a portal to some other place or time, whether within the bloom, an alien world, or a new dimension. Okay. The passageway leading to the next segment of the vehicle is blocked by debris. This is as far as you'll be able to go. Where? I want to go back to... I want this to be like a little shortcut. Back to the Mamavira's courtyard. That'd be sweet.
I'm going.
Maybe this thing will help. A pale blue light. Oh my. What are we looking at here? A pale blue light pulses gently. The air in this space feels charged, almost solid. A small glass control panel, apparently hovering in the air, winks with light and fills with tiny images. You raise your hand to touch the panel. Before you touch it, ghosts materialize around you, crowding you with their intangible presence, with their need. Torkra, the nearly transparent Vargellan, speaks. What do you intend with this? Suffering will come if you persist. You close your eyes and listen to the psychic center of the ghosts, and then you realize that they have no thoughts of their own. They are being controlled from a central point. You focus your thoughts at the core, but its psychic defenses are impenetrable. Who are you people? One of the men, his fine clothes looking slightly disheveled and stained, looks at you for a moment, as if weighing whether to tell you the truth. At last he says, "I am Anstall. I do not exist." The other man takes up the thread of the conversation. "I am Saradig, a merchant noble. I was on a pleasure cruise and sought to expand my business. Neither do I exist." The woman points to herself and says, "An. The others are Torkra, the Vargellan, Bindari, and her companion, Mithanwi." She gestures. "We do not exist because we are dead, crushed to death in the crash. We are projections of," and now the voice changes, "my memory. I am the Catena's intelligence. These projections are the memorial of my failure to serve my passengers." The Vargellan answers your question. "We have told you already. We are the projections of," the voice changes, continuing, "my machine mind. They exist now as a memorial to the fallen passengers, a testament to my own failure to save them." "Why would you create a memorial for your passengers?" Oh, Kian's one of them. "Why would you create a memorial for your passengers?"
"Updated my journal."
Another ghost steps forward. "Mithanwi, I retain memories of my passengers' actions. I watched them live. I felt them die within me. What else can I do but provide a memorial for them? They would have lived for many more years were it not for my failure." "Guilt. Here he is. Give this friggin' starship to the Maw." "I was endowed with a desire to pilot the container, to cause my passengers to arrive safely. This is denied to me. My secondary objective is retaining the knowledge and memory of the circumstances leading up to and surrounding their deaths. This will aid in reconstructing the events of the crash and may provide solace to their survivors. Until such time as a qualified diagnostician arrives, I cannot permit my cores to go dormant. Instead, the emotion I quantify as grief powers my display." "I may have a way to give your passengers a more lasting memorial. I carry a shared mind space in my psyche. If we can link our minds, we could preserve the memories of your riders." One of the ghosts, Bindari, you think, says, "In your mind. It's not a question. None of my medical records indicates such a thing as possible." Her partner, Mithanwi, adds, "However, I concede that my knowledge is incomplete. If it is possible, but no. My duty is to keep the passengers' memories alive here." "Do you know that one of the passengers survived? A woman named Kian still lives nearby." The projections speak at once. "My external sensors were destroyed. Some passengers were ejected. Calculations suggested that none could have survived such an event. I am grateful for this information." The Katana's voice is subdued, almost pensive. Ignore the ghosts and interact with the control panel, I guess. You study the control panel carefully. If the Catena were in motion, you suspect it would convey much more information than is currently available. As it is, you are able to see that it has traveled to thousands of destinations along a route that follows specific dimensional pathways on a circuit that, if you're reading this right, reached through the stars. The panel brings up a wealth of information about the Catena's systems in the form of tiny animated images. One of the icons appears to initiate the sequence to eject the Catena's power core. Do I want to do this? Or do I want to persuade it to give me information? I'll try this. I'm not sure what I'm doing. You press the icon. Immediately, a host of other icons spring to life. From what you can tell, multiple steps must occur before the power core can be removed. You'll have to draw the power source from the assembly, direct it into a containment unit, and then cause the containment anchors to release. Then you can extract the unit from the machine. It seems like this should be fairly straightforward, if laborious. The Vargellan ghost interposes itself. "We are concerned. We ask you to reconsider." You ignore him and press another icon. Lightning begins to dance across the panel. If you're not careful, you might get hurt. I don't know if I want to... Yeah. I'm not sure if this is the right answer, or to try to persuade it. Continue the process of ejecting the core, working around the arcs of electricity. I can get to 85. Success. It appears that the arcs fire in a complicated pattern, but a few moments of regarding that pattern settles it in your mind. Your fingers dart in and out until at last you manage to complete the process. The power core has been ejected from the assembly. Now you need to move it into the containment unit. You start that transfer sequence, but suddenly the control panel goes dark. The ghosts thicken around you. You will doom us to oblivion. Under their voices, a stronger undercurrent thrums, a subsonic pulse that quivers in your gut. They're not real. Divert power back to the control panel. 100. We definitely need a rest. You tap the broken power image. The old icons disappear, and a new screen of options appears. You study it carefully. One of the images shows an alien claw swiping through a complicated series of gestures at the panel, and then pushing an icon that looks like a wave. You imitate its motions, and the panel winks back to full functionality. Now that the power has been restored, you are able to complete the transfer of the core, it appears, at least according to the instructions, that the only task remaining is to remove the containment unit. Unfortunately, the unit appears to be stuck. The column of light has locked the containment device into place. It seems the Catena is working to stop you. The ghosts of the passengers crowd around you, and though they cannot touch you, they can distract you. Light shines into your eyes, voices fill your ears, and all of them whisper and urge you to stop what you intend. Disable lore machinery. 100. Success. Oh, I'm really drained. Leaning close, you study the icons and symbols, trying to ascertain their meanings. It looks like you need to enter information in the proper order. You settle in for applied experimentation. Slowly, methodically, you uncover the correct sequence. You enter it, and the containment field winks out. Blue tide is raised a huge amount. I'm not sure if I've seen huge amount, maybe once before. Please stop, the ghosts whisper as one. Please. You open the containment unit, revealing a single functional power source. Is it because I want to get this power source to use as like a cipher or artifact or something? The others are silent and dead. You examine the active power supply more closely, and a sudden shift in perspective leaves you nauseous.
Making a note.
I've gained a transdimensional power source. Oh, maybe for the, that... We can use it for that sword. Yaksu's sword. It is as if you looked down a billion stars swirling around holes of pure emptiness. Sound like black holes. A darkness deeper than anything you have ever seen before. You see red lines shift toward infrared and then blackness. And then the holes burst open in a fountain of brilliant white. The foundation scatters stars that circle around new holes, fade to black, and the cycle repeats. The Catena seems to run on collapsing singularities. Cool. This cylinder was one of 10 that once fueled the crashed Catena in the bloom. It appears to tap into the power of collapsing singularities. It is a rare source of energy, and only a few special devices would benefit from its unique properties. Cool. The lights in the Catena flicker and dim, fading slowly as the residual power within them expires. The further lights go first, darkness matching along the Catena toward the power source. As the slow wave of darkness builds, it snatches the ghosts into oblivion as well. I kind of feel bad for the starship, who seemed to be sentient. Still gold and blue. Oh, here is a quest item. So where's this sword? Right, mesmeric handle. This device is inert because it lacks power. But its potential energies are great, tapped and conducted through strange dimensions. It would require an appropriate power source to reactivate the missing blade. Cool. The device resembles the hilt of a weapon. It rests easily in your hand, but there is no blade. Yaksu. Attempt to insert the transdimensional power source into the handle. 100.
Making a note.
Cool. Transdimensional scalpel. You take out the cylinder that you found in the crash catena and try to slide it into the compartment on the hilt. Initially it looks as though it won't quite fit, but you discover that if you press the cylinder gently against the opening, it gradually resizes itself and fits neatly inside. A small, fine blade of pure transdimensional energy sprouts from the hilt. You realize that this device is a scalpel. With the twist of a hand, the blade can quickly be switched on or off. Cool. It's a light melee weapon. Ooh, I can use this. It's bound to be better than my weapon. I think I still have that crystal. On critical hits, wielder gains phase. Convert all damage to transdimensional. Grants plus 30% evasion, plus 3 resistance. Except transdimensional damage dealt to this character is plus 100%. Active one round. A small fine blade of transdimensional energy extends from a hilt of azure steel. With a twist of the hand, it can quickly be switched on and off. The scalpel cuts through dimensions, rapidly shimmering between different realities and ignoring most mundane armors. Inscribed into the hilt is the name Yaksu. Cool. I want to see, compare, but I guess that's only a merchant screen. Okay, so 4 transdimensional. Suppose it has this phase thing. Grants plus 30 evasion. 30% evasion. Only on critical hits, though. But anyway, we get to a max of plus 15. 4. To a max of plus 15 rather than 3 and a max plus 9, so. Cool. Pretty sweet. Does it always make that noise? I was hoping we could cut through here. Huh.
All right. All right.
Bereft of its power source, the containment device no longer glows. The control panel is dark and unresponsive. Okay.
Yes, now.
No more ghosties.
Action! Here I come!
That was cool. Nice little zone. Once we figured out that quest. Now, after I take care of some quests up here, different areas, we have 3 different mods to go through. One here, one in the old slave block, and we still have to find something over there. It's here that we need to go.
Yes.
We have a bunch of things to take care of in the Numenera's courtyard. I guess we'll just head over there. It is done.
Go.
Kian Bruska. And, the, what do you call it? This thing. The decanted.
Of course.
Of course, the decanted, you know. Two more people to tell you about. The creature's voice remains flat and expressionless. Greetings. The Murdens in the old slave block captured an attractive woman. They've modified her brain, though.
Making a note.
Exposure to Murdens can lead to long-term ill effects. We will contact associates to verify the specimen's suitability. It may take some time. Okay, we can't tell them about... what's her name? Because she ran off somewhere. Alright. Kian, right here. Very handy. Kian raises her head in a businesslike manner, belied only by her surroundings. You've returned. I don't suppose you've learned anything new about Delny and Vrung? Delny won't be bothering you anymore, and Vrung is gone. For good, I hope.
I'll remember that.
Ooh, we got a heat cup? Well, she says, the doubt in her voice clear. I certainly hope you're right. Regardless, you have done more than I ever could, and you have my gratitude. She produces a pouch from her pocket. Please accept this and thanks. If Vrung is truly gone, I can afford a little excess. Also, you may feel free to sleep here anytime, no charge. Woohoo! Nice, because we need it. She thinks, I wonder what she could have done to Vrung. I hope she remains amiable toward me. What she could have done to Vrung. I remain amiable towards you. Gave me a heat cup and I got free sleep. That's awesome. This cup appears to have been roughly carved in one piece from a graphite material. It leaves a black residue on your fingers any time you touch it. Certain, but not all, liquids poured into this cup will be heated to a boiling point immediately. There's no apparent pattern in what liquids it will or will not heat up, but it seems to activate specifically with synthetic liquids. My machinery lore tells me that there is no discernible power source on the device enabling it to heat the liquids. It could be the graphite material itself is the source of that energy. Because it is so difficult to activate, it does not seem to be possible to tap directly into the cup's power source. Huh. I'd like to sleep here, then. Of course. She waves toward an empty tent. I'll bring you some food shortly and I'll tell you some stories if you like. Enjoy your night. Look at how much money we have. Over 2,000 shins.